either in the form of a newsletter or something. So that work is being done, just so you know. Thank you. And Mikhail, your point is well taken, and I think, like I mentioned before, that you know, most of our parents who grew up were in a South Asian environment. Over there, it wasn't so much about preserving the religion as it was just kind of keeping it, you know, just following it, basically. And here, when you preserve a system or an ideology, you have to understand the ideology, right? You know, the survival of an ideology is the spread of it, obviously. And to understand that, you have to get the spread of it about. And so that's where I think this kind of, this fork in the road is. And now our youth are here, and now they're questioning, not questioning everything, not in a negative way, but they want to know, why am I doing this? Don't tell me to do these 10 things. So you know what, you do these 10 things, and this is the reason why you're doing these 10 things. And that may not have existed when, you know, let's say our parents were our age. You know, I don't know how many of you remember when you were 24 or 23 in Pakistan, India, wherever you were, but go back to those times and ask yourself, you know, thank you, what kind of vision of Islam did you have? Did you have this idea of understanding why you do certain things and how you do certain things? Or was it just like, you know what, Baba said so, so I did it. Ask yourself. You know, 25 in India, yes. Alaikum salam. Yeah, I don't think he was saying that the parents need to be blamed. I think he was saying that the amount of responsibility and burden that's on the shoulders of you guys should be shared amongst you and the parents. And this isn't a parent versus child debate, nor is it the topic of my discussion tonight. But this is about, you know, understanding that this is a group aspect that, you know, it starts from the home and then goes outside. And I think there's a movement here amongst parents, if you agree, that there is a little bit of now movement towards raising their children differently.
Yeah. I'm not saying the onus is on the parents alone. I'm saying that the onus has to be shared.
Sure, yeah.
And education, is, yeah. Education isn't limited to the younger generation. Everyone's always learning and certain
absolutely.
Are building in it. So
absolutely.
So if we're not all on that same page, then we're not moving in any direction.
Yeah. Yeah. If our perspective of the religion is that you're good as long as you're in these four walls, then it goes back to Abbas's point about ma'rifat of the religion. We don't have enough of it, I guess. And so we really need to, you know, these islands come from all corners of the globe, you know. There are people here who are 30, 15, 20 years in Qom, people, and, you know, and they sit here after the program alone. I feel so sorry for them. Sit around, ask them questions, talk to them. You'd be surprised. You know, they just sit there, they drink their tea, and they go home. You know, if they find a benefit from them, you know, Al-Mahdi is bringing them from corners of the globe, and like I said, after the program, they sit there and they go home. But, you know, this idea of, you know, you just have resources at your fingertips. You know, to build that mindset, but then ultimately to change that perspective of being, so it's outside these four walls. So whatever you are here, you're also outside, inshallah. Please. We make our religion very difficult, I'm afraid.
That's the thing. The thing is, in fact, it is very easy to practice. We make ourselves in a very difficult situation.
Yes.
Like, for example, and that creates multiple lives for us. Our lives, the life of our home is different, the life of our mosque is different, the life of our office becomes different, and life of our outside the office, it becomes different because we created it in the first place. In fact, from our actions, from our thinking, from our not taking an initiative. For example, it's very easy to practice in office. It's not very hard. The thing is, the conviction to the religion, the conviction that we are not ashamed of being a Muslim. The prayer time comes. You don't have to be a very knowledgeable person.
Right.
Over 14, you have to pray. That's it. So the prayer time comes. Okay, this is the time for prayer. You go pray. Nobody stops you. Maybe it creates a little hesitation in the first place, for the first instinct. But once you start doing it, it becomes a common practice. Nobody bothers here. even every single person is accommodating, understanding. So it starts with the prayer, and it even on a personal note, it even happened to us an incident, like my own boss at 12 o'clock. He sees me going for the prayer, right? So he's very hungry one day, his sugar level dropped. I said, okay, I'll take you for the lunch. It's 12 o'clock. He says, no, this is your prayer time.
Yeah.
They understand.
They respect it too, actually.
Yeah. And there was a situation where they were ripping off the office. They said, no, don't rip this office off because this is the prayer place.
Mm.
So it becomes very, very easy. I mean, the initiation is the tough part.
Yeah.
So when you go to the school, I went to the alias parent-teacher meeting, and the teacher offered her hand. I said, with due respect, I cannot shake hands. And then after the meeting, she said sorry, and then she started with the meeting and everything. And after the meeting is over, she said, I have a couple of questions to ask you. And then she asked me, was there any problem in shaking hands? And then I explained it to her. She said, it's a good knowledge that you have given me. I have to be careful
right.
in the first instinct, in the first place.
Right.
So it's very easy. Unless and until you practice, you take the initiative, nothing works. And I don't want to say only youth. It's ourselves too. I have so many people in the office and I see them. Within the first 6 weeks, 1 month of joining the office, they will eat anything and everything. So it's not just the youth, it's even the adults. If you want to become an apologetic person and then you want to give up, people tend to give up easily because they don't have knowledge. This is where the problem is. Whatever knowledge we have, instead of applying it, we want to give it up to the society. So if the other Muslim does, it makes sense to some extent, but we should not be doing it. We can still practice. And I think if we continue doing it, it becomes easy. I mean, it becomes a norm for us. That's all.
I think also, just to kind of come back on topic, because I know we're losing topic here, I think also sometimes it's the way that the religion has been presented to us as well. I think that, you know, to give an example, you know, if I was to present to you guys, you know, a very nice, delicious halim or hormar or nahari, or whatever you guys, you know, nice, juicy T-bone steak with, like, you know, and I put it on the back side of a garbage lid, and I give it to you guys, right? No matter how delicious it might look or how beautiful it is, the presentation isn't very positive. And so sometimes Islam has been presented to us as a series of no's and yeses. You can't do this, you can't wear that, you can't eat here, don't do this, don't go there, don't listen to that, don't talk to this person, don't shake her hand, don't wear that color. And now our perspective on religion has been so limited to this series of laws. I follow or break. It's not like that. It's a complete perspective system of life. If that T-bone steak is on a nice, beautiful plate, then we'll enjoy it. On the back of the garbage, it's going to be a problem. So we need to really present Islam to our youth as a complete solution to their problems, not the problem. And that's obviously the onus of a lot of people, be it the ulama, be it management, be it our elders, be it yourself. You know? So this is a joint effort in making sure that our presentation of the deen is proper to these kids. It's important.
I have a question. This Wednesday at my school, there was a display in the library for four religions, Sikhism, Hinduism, Christianity, and Islam. So my class went to it and we saw some of the exhibits. And they went by okay. And then the next day, my religion teacher, he said everything was good, but he talked about Islam. He said that there was a lady, she was a guest speaker. He said that what she was saying was wrong, that Islam doesn't allow dating or relationships like with men and women. So he got really angry. Like, he was yelling. He was saying, no, they're wrong. They came to Canada, they're using our resources.
He's a Muslim?
No. It's a Catholic school, so. And so he, and then he's...
So he was saying Islam does allow dating and...
No, he's saying it's wrong that they're saying it's not allowed to date.
It's wrong, not allowed to date, okay.
Yeah. So he's like, you're